Will you please stand? Please be seated. Family and friends, we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Gary Kahlstorf. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, and in death, resurrection. Please join me and let us pray. Gracious and loving Father, who gave us birth, you know our needs before we ask. Give to us now your grace, that we may see the light of eternity. Help us to live as those who are prepared to die, and when our days are accomplished, enable us to die as those who go forth to live, so that living or dying, our life may be in you, and that nothing in life or death will be able to separate us from your great love in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. So most of you know that I knew Gary for a brief time, and as I was processing all of this, so many things I hope to talk to him about, but the things that I learned about him and wondered if I knew them correctly, which I did, kind of all came together. Jason had written a small thing for me to read for him, and also some scriptures to go along with that. I'm going to share those with you. My dad was the most kind and generous man I've ever known. He never placed his own interests or desires over anyone else's. I remember as a young boy tagging along with my dad to visit numerous people in the community. Some of them lived alone, were widowed, or just close friends of his. He always had other people and their deeds on his mind. He never wanted to be the center of attention. He displayed Christ-like servitude that we should all emulate. My dad will be greatly missed by me, my family, and his numerous friends. From 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 11 through 12. Make it your ambition to lead a quiet life and attend to your own business and work with your hands, just as we commanded you, so that you may behave properly toward outsiders and not be in any need. Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. Beware of practicing your righteousness before men to be noticed by them. Otherwise, you have no reward with your Father who is in heaven. And then looking forward, Joshua chapter 1, verse 9. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not tremble or be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. If you would please, if you'd like to, the music, it would be in your hymnals on page 710. I believe the words are on the screen. We'll sing together, Faith of Our Fathers.
It's just the best. I don't know how to say. say it. It's just the best scripture to read today. John 14. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. What a tremendous passage of scripture. Jesus had just had this incredible conversation with his disciples. There in the upper room, it started with Jesus washing their feet. That must have been something. And then as the night went on, Jesus told them, one of you is going to betray me. And they're looking at each other, you know, and all that. Then he went and told them that he was going to be delivered up and put to death. Then Peter, of course, stood up and said, no, no, I'll never let that happen. And he had to rebuke Peter. And then he told Peter, before the rooster crows, you'll deny me three times. Now, after that conversation, he then says to them, let not your heart be troubled. Wow. Isn't that amazing? Let not your heart be troubled. Well, life has a lot of troubling things in it. And we're here today because of another one. And yet, the Lord would say to us, yeah, there's a lot of things in this life that are broken. A lot of things that are difficult. A lot of things you're not going to like. But in the whole scale of things, you don't have to let your heart be troubled. And then he goes on to tell us why. And he tells us, first of all, of the promise of the Father's house, which we would call heaven. The promise of the Father. The promise that this life is not it. Now, this is all through Scripture. It's all through Scripture. I mean, David talked about it in the 23rd Psalm. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Paul, of course, referred to it. He said it this way, if this earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. So all through Scripture, it talks to us about the Father's house. Now, this is Jesus, right? I mean, if Jesus says something, he only has to say it once, and that's it. It's true for all times. But interestingly enough, on this occasion, he actually puts a little emphasis on it. He tells them about the Father's house, and then he says, if it were not so, I would have told you. I think he really wants us to get it. He really does. But then Jesus goes on to talk about the preparation of a place in the Father's house. Now, it's interesting. It's not the preparation of the Father's house. That's perfect. That's perfect heaven. It's always been there. In fact, it's where Jesus came from when he came to earth to become a human and live amongst us. But he said, I go to perfect or prepare a place for you. Wow. If the disciples would have understood that, at the point, they would have understood why he had to die. Now, if we'd have been there, we wouldn't have understood it either at this point. But heaven's perfect, and we're not. Oh, if we just go to heaven the way we are, heaven won't be perfect anymore. That can't be. So what do you do about it? Well, Jesus was telling them what we know. The scripture says the wages of sin is death. So if Jesus is going to pay the wages of our sin, what does he have to do? He had to die. That's why he just got done telling them that I'm going to be delivered up and put to death. And no wonder they were upset. But he was really telling them the great good news. This is how I will prepare so that this is how I will prepare the place so that you can go. Wow. That's why in Matthew 20:28, Jesus said the Son of Man did not come to serve, did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life, pay the wages for many. Okay. I want to interrupt this now for a minute. Knowing Gary, I don't know that he would like this, but I want to talk about Gary for a little bit. If I had to describe Gary, I would say he was a humble servant. That's the way he was. Talk about the Father's house. Well, this is the church. It's not the Father's house. This isn't heaven, but this place has been dedicated to God, to his worship, and to this, the study of his people, and so we call this the house of the Lord. But talk about preparing this place. Gary, and I have to include Vicki in this. Gary and Vicki prepared this place I don't know how many times. And in this house are many rooms, by the way. And they prepared them all. Gary, as a servant, did so much for this church. In fact, every church that amounts to anything has people like this in it. But he did so much for this church that you didn't even know about. I'm telling you, a faith Bible church for I don't know how long to come will be saying, who did that? Oh yeah. Who made the coffee every Sunday morning and then took it to all the adult Sunday school rooms? The fellowship hall is looking a little, the floor is looking a little dingy. Who mopped that and buffed it? Oh, that's right. Gary. And that list will go on and on and on. And if I would share all that's on my heart right now, you wouldn't want to stay here that long. So, but I did, and I do on some occasions, I asked Brenda, why? Tell me something that struck you about Gary. She said, you can never get ahead of it. You can never outserve it. For years we did the Good Friday services. We had a live crucifixion. And so this place was completely taken apart up here. The altar was moved out. We had an old piece of carpet we had to lay down because when you lifted up Jesus, the blood dripped down on the floor. That was phony blood, by the way. I don't want anybody to misunderstand. But anyway, so when it was over, you'd move the cross out And then you come in with the soap and water and clean up that carpet, but now it's wet, so you can't put it away. And we'd say every year, Gary, we'll be back Saturday morning to straighten this place out. And Brenda, not me of course, but Brenda kept coming earlier every Saturday after Good Friday. And it was all cleaned up when she got here, every time. And we'd say, Gary, you didn't have to do that. We were coming. And he'd say every time, oh, that wasn't anything. Boy, that was really a good service we had last night. He instantly, don't talk about me. Move it over to something else. Brenda had something else she wanted to share. You probably know he was a craftsman. I mean, I can't believe this guy's talent because you'd never know it because he'd never tell you about it. But one day he came in and he gave Brenda a cutting board that he'd made. I had to bring it along. You have to see this thing. It's incredible. It's beautiful. Brenda said there's just one problem. I will never cut anything on it because I am not going to take the chance of scratching it. But it's something. A humble servant. Yeah. Well, Jesus also said, if you want to be great in the kingdom of God, learn to be a servant of all. You can draw your own conclusions about Gary from that one. Wow. Well, we have the promise of the Father's house. We have the preparation of the Father's house. And then, of course, we have the pathway to the Father's house. How for sure can you know that you'll get there? Well, they didn't know at first. Thomas was the one who jumped right out and said, Lord, we don't know where you're going and we don't know how to get there. And then Jesus said what I think might be the greatest, clearest statement of salvation through Christ ever proclaimed, when he said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one gets to the Father except through me. So, what's the most important thing I can share with you about Gary? Gary had received Jesus Christ into his heart as his personal Savior. You see, as we talk about Gary, and that'll go on and on and on, what a wonderful man he was. But he's not in heaven because he was a wonderful man. He's not in heaven because he cleaned his church 1,000 times, 1,000,000 times. I don't know how many times it's been. He's not in heaven because he thought about other people and did all that. I'm convinced you'll be rewarded for that. But there's only one way to get to heaven. And that's through the Lord Jesus Christ, because he paid the wages that had to be paid. And it's by putting our faith in him. Gary had a living faith, and the faith he lived, the faith, and he was a learner. He kept learning. Scott took a picture of Gary, and of course Gary didn't even know it. Yes, please put it up. This is precious. I'm going to try not to cry. Here's Gary sitting in his workshop. You can see his tools on the wall behind him. There's some wood there, and I don't know if those are plans or blueprints or what they're on, but there sits Gary reading his Bible. Of course, out in his workshop. Of course, where nobody was supposed to see him. But there he sits. Well, I think Gary's brother Dan grabbed it. We were at the hospital and Gary had passed and there were people coming. And Dan and Ren came in and Dan looked at his brother Gary and he turned and he said to me, "Well, there's no doubt where he is." I think that grabbed it right there. Gary's death was a shock. Terrible shock. Far as I could get, he was living an ordinary day. And I think he heard a thump and I went in to see, and within a few hours, he was gone. Wow. Let me say a couple of things about that and I'll be done. It should remind all of us that life is limited. You know, and I hope I say this right. I could come around and ask every one of you, do you know that if Jesus doesn't come back, do you know that someday you're going to die? And every one of us would say, yes, I know that. But not a one of us, including me, thinks it's going to be today, or tomorrow, or next week. And that's okay. Don't get me wrong. I don't think God wants you getting up every morning going, oh, I wonder if this is the day I'm going to die. No, he wants you to get up and live it. Get out there and live it. But the Bible does tell us to be aware of the fact that this life is very fragile. And we really don't know. And the second thing I want to ask you in this one, I don't know if Gary would like me talking about him, but I know he'd like me asking this question. Are you ready? Are you ready? Have you asked the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the only one who can take us to the Father's house, to be your Savior? 2 Corinthians 6:2 says, today is the day of salvation. Now, it doesn't tell us that. It says that it doesn't mean today is the day I'm going to die. I don't know what it means. It means today could be. And I need to know Jesus today. Are you ready? Most important thing I can say about Gary, and you'll be talking about him for a long time, but most important thing is that he was ready. Yeah, he was. I pray that everybody here comes to the place where when that day comes that we pass out of this life, somebody can stand up and with confidence say, well, there's no doubt where they are. And if we know Jesus, that's true. If we ask Jesus to be our Savior, there's no doubt where we'll be. The promise, God's house. Jesus did all necessary to prepare to pay for our sin. And I believe he prepared a place for everybody, but unfortunately not everybody accepted his invitation. But if we do, then he is the pathway. He will come and get us and take us to that place. And that's why, as shocking and as sad as this is, we can say once again, let not your heart be troubled. Will you pray with me? Lord, I feel like I fell short of words when I think of my brother Gary. But I do know that the gospel of Jesus is absolutely true, and it's for every one of us. I pray, Lord, that everybody here today can turn to that. If they don't know you already, Lord, you're just an invite away. But for all who do, may it somehow once again fill our hearts and give us the strength and the comfort we need. Thank you, Jesus, that you are the way, the truth, and the life. Pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
You'd like to follow along on the screen or on page 364 in your hymnals, let's join together and sing Because He Lives. join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Now receive the Lord's blessing. Now may the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, according to the riches of God's glory, grant you to be strengthened with might through God's Spirit in your inner being, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ which surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Thank you.